Hello, welcome back to Dr. Darnise's House of Religion, Magic, and Conjure. Thank you all for joining me. As you know, I always appreciate you liking, sharing, and subscribing. The channel is growing, y'all. So much so that I wanted to come on and share a couple of things. One is that I'm working on a new book and on Hoodoo, and so I wanted to come on and share with that about that, and also because we do have new people, I wanted to share what that is about. Maybe you've been following for a while and you're like, I don't even know exactly what Hoodoo is. That the same thing as voodoo or whatever, or other African religions? And so I'm sure I've talked about it before, but I will talk about it some more here to define, because I'm kind of in that mindset since I'm doing some research for the new book. So again, I'm writing a book on Hoodoo, and Hoodoo is the African American folk magical or folk spiritual tradition. So it's not a religion. It's not voodoo. It's not Orisha worship per se. It is the practices that African Americans in the South who were enslaved maintained and used, one as a form of resistance to white supremacy and slavery, and also as a form of medicine. You know, it's plant-based. It's about, you know, finding those things in nature that are for our good, are for our healing. You know, I talk about the law of correspondence when I talk to you all about, you know, doing spell work, or what difference does this crystal make versus that crystal, or this color candle versus that color candle. And that has to do with the law of correspondences. And so when you're trying to change your circumstances, because that's what magic is, right? It's a intentional way of changing your circumstances using the ingredients at hand, basically nature, using the things of nature to change your circumstances to your own benefit. And that, of course, is outside the realm of traditional religion. Traditional religion will tell you that you need to go to an external God and pray to that God so that that God will change things for you. But in systems that are about personal magic, folk traditions, of which, you know, Africans have one set, we can take some matters into our own hands. And so I'm so always fascinated with the ways that African Americans have done this. I've been going over the last 2 or 3 years now to Savannah, Georgia, doing research there, because that's where the Sea Islands are and where Gullah Geechee culture is. And so I've been doing research in that region because it's a very rich repository or area where you can find a lot of these African traditions that are still embedded in the culture. So when I talk about Hoodoo, I'm really talking about this very old system that African Americans have used for survival, for health, for resistance to white supremacy. And, you know, it's thought of, if at all, it's thought of as, you know, oh, somebody put roots on me. It's thought of as something that's evil, something that's not understood. You know, we've all been under the influence of the Europeans and the Euro-Americans who tell us that those things that come from Africa are backwards or heathenish, not real religion, and, you know, that we're savages who had no civilization and no real spirituality. So we know different. And so it's so fascinating to me to go into regions of the country where you can still find a lot of it, really, you know, almost on the surface of the culture, of the modern culture. So Charleston, South Carolina is that way. Savannah, Georgia is that way. New Orleans also. And although New Orleans has a bit more of the actual voodoo, the religion of voodoo, you find that more of that in New Orleans, as, you know, Haiti as well. So just know that that system, voodoo or vodun, is more of an actual religious system to which you would be initiated, to which there are certain, you know, doctrine and rule, sort of structure, I'll say a structure to follow. Whereas Hoodoo does not really have a structure per se. It is about learning how to use the things of nature to your benefit. And it is true, you could learn to use those things to the detriment of others in terms of your own survival and self-protection. And so one thing I wanted to share with you is this deck, this Hoodoo tarot deck that I recently got. This is an interesting picture on the card itself. This is a portion you can of the United States where Hoodoo was practiced. So right here you can see, you know, Florida, all the way over here to Texas. So that's what you're looking at. Up here to maybe North Carolina, or just the top, the north area of South Carolina. So from South Carolina all the way down to Georgia, Florida, and all the way over to Texas is where you would find African Americans practicing Hoodoo. So I really love it that the artist put that on the back of these cards. And then, you know, the front of the cards have pictures of life that African people, African American people would have recognized as meaningful. Y'all know I made another video about the Rider-Waite Smith deck, and how there's an African American woman who created that deck. And that's, as I said, they are probably the most well used, or at least well known, tarot deck, I would say probably of around the world. And so to find this Hoodoo deck, though, the Hoodoo tarot, I had to have it, right? I had to have it. And so I've been loving it. But I also wanted to read you something. Y'all know I'm a scholar. I always got to read something, right? About Frederick Douglass. And you might not have known that Frederick Douglass went to a conjure man or hoodoo man back in the day to give him some assistance against a slave breaker or an overseer type of a person. And so Frederick Douglass was in the situation of being passed off, I guess I would say, to a overseer, we'll call him Edward Covey, who had a strong reputation for being, you know, someone who could break even the most strong-willed African. And so Frederick Douglass had some run-ins with this overseer and wanted something to protect himself from that overseer. And so, although he was a Christian, Frederick Douglass was a Christian, he went to a conjurer by the name of Sandy Jenkins, and this was in Easton, Maryland. And he went to Jenkins and said that he needed some protection and some help against the white man who was going to brutalize him. And so in Douglass's words, Sandy says, "Sandy was not only a religious man, but he professed to believe in a system for which I have no name." This is Douglass's account. "He was a genuine African and had inherited some of the so-called magical powers said to be possessed by African and Eastern nations. Sandy instructed Douglass to find the root of a herb in the forest that had mystical powers of protection." That's what a good hoodoo doctor or conjure doctor will tell you. There are some roots out here. There are some herbs out here that will help you. That's the law of correspondence. After undisclosed preparation, Sandy further instructed Douglass to wear the root on his right side because it would be impossible for Covey to strike a blow, that with this root, no white man could whip him. To Douglass, talk of magically endowed herbs and roots was very absurd and ridiculous, if not positively sinful. These statements were guided in part by his acceptance of Christianity and can also be viewed as an appeal to both his writing audience and his fellow abolitionists. One of the key arguments used by abolitionists to undermine the legitimacy of slavery was that few slaves received true Christian instruction. This was tangibly measured by the persistence of heathen or savage African religious practices in the plantation South. So there was knowledge that even though African people had been converted to Christianity, that something was in them was resistant to full conversion, because they still insisted, these African people enslaved, insisted on maintaining their African understanding, their African cosmology, and their African practices. They just didn't let it go, even though they were forced into Christianity. And so to me, that isn't that interesting? Like, you could not shake it. You could not separate it from that African. Right. So African religious practices in the plantation South, despite Douglass's obvious disdain for conjure, he still wore the root. In August 1834, a confrontation Douglass had with Covey involved a protracted wrestling bout between the two that rendered the former Negro breaker as gentle as a lamb for the next 6 months that Douglass lived with him. Although Douglass never fully acknowledged it, the root in his right pocket was certainly a factor in his new spirit of assertiveness and resistance. So I'm reading this from a journal article, Conjure, Magic, and Power, The Influence of Afro-Atlantic Religious Practices on Slave Resistance and Rebellion by Walter Rucker. It's in the Journal of Black Studies from 2001. Again, Conjure, Magic, and Power, The Influence of Afro-Atlantic Religious Practices on Slave Resistance and Rebellion by Walter Rucker, 2001. And you can probably just find this online or something similar. You could just Google Frederick Douglass and the Conjure Doctor, Sandy Jenkins, and probably find it as well, because it's such a well-known story, and it's such an interesting story because there's an acknowledgement that Africans were still knowledgeable about these practices and still using them in the antebellum South, and that even white people were aware of it, that you couldn't, you know, get black people to stop, and white people were afraid of it. White people were afraid of conjure doctors. And then, and throughout most of the American South, African people were forbidden from drumming, because white people figure there's some communication that's happening in this drumming. And so we have to stamp out as much of that African culture as we possibly can. And drumming was one of the things. The only place where we find there could be drumming was in New Orleans. And so Marie Laveau, for example, would have these services, you might call them, on Congo Square on Sundays. And so she was a person who could both be Catholic and practice Vodun. But to the observer, the casual observer, she was Catholic. But at Congo Square, she had the African drum. So anyway, I'm just sharing this with y'all. So because I'm so excited about the hoodoo that I'm working on. And also to let you know that, in case you did not, that hoodoo is a set of spiritual practices sort of divorced from any particular religion that our ancestors were using as a way of actual resistance to oppression. And a lot of times that's lost. That knowledge is just lost because, you know, we live in a society that wants to divorce us from our Africanness. And many of us do it to our own selves at this point, right? We don't know enough about it ourselves. And so we discount it, we minimize it, we separate ourselves from it as something that, you know, backwards black people did down south. But when you really understand that this is a continuation of practices and knowledge, cosmological knowledge, metaphysical knowledge from Africa, it should really encourage you. And so the book that I'm writing is intended to encourage us more as well, because like I keep saying, we will not be erased, not on my watch. Our history, our contributions will not be erased. I am determined to teach, to educate, to keep alive those things that helped our ancestors survive and can help us now in these times. Because, you know, here we are needing to actively resist white supremacy again in the 21st century in the United States of America. We still need the resources by which we have to protect ourselves. So anyway, I think I will wrap it up there. And yeah, go back over here and get with these cards again. I guess I'll just share this one here. If you know the tarot deck at all, the first card is number zero, right? It's the free man, is the fool, normally. The one who starts the journey. So the tarot is about this journey that we all take as a human, like through the stages of life. Zero card is the very beginning, right? And so in this particular deck, it is, instead of being called the fool, it is the free man. And you see a man here walking away from the plantation out an open gate. So that's what I mean by the hoodoo deck really tells us something about, well, it situates it in our own experience as African-American people here. So the free man is walking away and he's got a jar of dirt in his hand. You can see that he's got a jar of dirt. So he's taking something with him, right? And so I think I have, yeah. And the number one is normally the magician. So Black Herman, another one of our gurus, another one of our spiritual and mystic leaders. Black Herman was somebody who was known to be, you might say, a hoodoo doctor, someone who knew how to manipulate the environment for his advantage. So Black Herman. Anyway, I'm going to wrap it up there. And as always, please leave me your comments, your questions, like, share, support, subscribe, all of that good stuff. I really appreciate all you new people as well. Welcome to Dr. Darnise's House of Religion, Magic, and Conjure. And that's it. Bye for now.